Welcome back, everybody. Here, the coverage of the TI5 qualifiers, the European division, as we're going into our next round of games, where we have the team united in their burden up against the team that are allied with each other. It is Alliance going up against Burden United. We're joined by the awesomest crew in the world, and should be fun.
What's up, guys? We flop spots. It's our turn to cast.
Yay!
Woo!
We're excited. We're pumped up and ready to go. We've been looking forward to this, and we get the pleasure of casting these two teams, both of them currently 1-1, sporting 1 point, so still relatively in the mix, but they need to kind of push themselves ahead of everyone else. Coming out here with a 2-0 win would be huge, but I don't know if it's going to come easy. Burden United, they're pretty crafty. We already know what Alliance can do.
What are we actually expecting from Burden United? It's probably the bigger question. We already saw Alliance here on the mainstream. We didn't actually get a cast Burden United. What are we expecting as far as playstyle goes?
They won one nip, so that's already pretty good. But this game, as you said, is of utmost importance. I'm not exactly sure what they're going to throw at them. I looked at their top picks. Looks like it's fairly standard across the board. But, Chen, Gyro, Wisp, nothing to write home about.
But not afraid to pull out something different. Like you said, they pulled out the Ember in the last game, something that most teams would probably look over, but they have also shown that they're happy to think outside the box a little bit. You have a puzzled look over here, Hani. What's up?
Yeah, I think something like a Kunkka I could also see to be possible. Sing Sing is one of those that enjoys the hero a lot, and it's been having an upcoming trend, so I would not be surprised seeing a hero.
All right. Well, what about for Alliance, gentlemen? Do you think we're just going to see good old Alliance where you got to make sure Burn United ban out the Nature's Prophet first, hit Bulldog where it hurts, don't let him have his comfort heroes? Should we expect
so.
The same? Yeah.
I think banning out NP and Wisp is probably the best idea. If they can utilize Chen, then you don't necessarily need to ban it, but he plays NP probably better than anyone else in the EU qualifiers.
It's just, I think, the way they like to work around. Mm-hmm. You know, the Nature's Prophet, when you have a Slaughter, heroes that can chase down, then you have always a Nature's Prophet that can join in, right? In that sense, I agree with a Nature's Prophet ban.
I would still look to see what Alliance has got up their sleeve. Like, they've only played one series so far, and it was this like initiation kind of style, but it was still the same kind of offlane that we saw like in both games. And then with the Nature's Prophet, it kind of like tipped the scales, and that helped them to win. So I'm still interested to see what Mads got prepared. He's still a fantastic captain. I'm still waiting to see where Alliance go when they run a safe lane, what they really turn to on Loader, and then what they turn to for Admiral Bulldog for that off lane. Like, we've got Lone Druid and Prophet and Clockwork all up there for him. We still have only seen, well, one of them. So I'm interested to see how Alliance are going to mix it up.
Their supports have been too quiet, I think. Like, the first game it was SD Dazzle. They didn't really do that much.
Yeah.
And that caused them to be in a really large deficit, like 15, 20 minutes.
But as Hani was saying, that's not also just their problem. Like, it was mainly the effect of Coddle pushing the lane back every time. They couldn't find what they wanted to be aggressive.
I mean, but it was picked very early. When you see that coming as the drafter, Mad, you have to, you know, be able to anticipate.
So you prefer to see more like roaming ganking kind of supports as opposed to this, we can combo with this guy.
If they can't play aggressively, they can pick an Enigma. It was one of his top heroes. He's played a fair amount, or someone that can do something versus BKB in a later game.
That's actually one thing we haven't seen so far. Like, where are the junglers? Where is this let's just battle the economy kind of thing? Like, the Chen was banned out against RK before because it was a Prophet and a Chen. You don't want to give that combo to Alliance. But, like, where is the Enigma?
I do believe there's a shaky phase just because of the bounty pickup that has been recently a lot in there. When you have a Chen, Ange, and Enigma, all struggle a lot against the bounty hunter. And I'm not sure if all teams are afraid of that bounty hunter, but he's been a big struggle for all junglers.
Yeah, and if you ban it out first, that means you're letting something else through. So you kind of risk maybe saving a kind of jungle strat to more the mid part of the draft, but then things can get a bit awkward from there. But speaking of draft, everyone, draft is underway. So why don't we go ahead and jump into it and we can
almost
really theory craft it.
Almost. We have to check out the sexiest pitches in the world.
Whoa.
Of Burden United.
Look at him.
I think Necroman gets the award for looking very similar to Bamboo.
Yeah, with crazier hair.
Yeah, with crazier hair. It's like,
it reminds me a bit of the old puppy hair. A bit.
I'm a little let down by my nuts, though.
You couldn't have the separation in the middle if you want the old puppy hair.
I was hoping for something a bit more, you know, rambunctious from a player with a name like My Nuts. Looks a little plain Jane there.
Maybe they're just plain nuts, all right?
Fair enough. You know, unsalted nuts are pretty boring after all. So, all right, I think we're ready now for a draft. Fair enough to say?
I think so, man. Yeah.
Let's do it. So with that, we're going to have the opening first pick. It's for Burden United, and there's their top pick coming into these playoffs. They've had Gyrocopter 9 times in 6.84 with a spotty record of 4-5. On the side of Alliance, well, look what it is. It's going to be the Leshrec, and they're going to be the team to actually pick up the Bounty Hunter. Interesting.
This is so open for Alliance. Like, when you get a Bounty Hunter, you can run him as a support. The Leshrec has been so powerful as a core, but it's also another one of these, like, you can meld it into a different style of lineup. I kind of like the first two pickups. However, picking up an Invis hero like a Bounty Hunter in the first phase, perhaps questionable.
Well, I like how they didn't pick up two supports. I think that's kind of what limited them in game number one with the SE Dazzle opener. With this and Leshrec, you can lane Leshrec, honestly, pretty much safe lane, off lane, mid lane, mm-hmm. and
well, Pycat
with very high success.
Pycat really enjoys it in the mid.
Actually, I wouldn't be 100% set on it's a support bounty here.
I was going to say the same thing.
Because Bulldog had played this hero in the past. It just used to be played on the off lane, and we've seen it just recently only being played as a second support. And you know, who knows? Like, it still could be coming back into that off lane, so I wouldn't take that out at all.
Yeah, but at the same time, like, okay, now we also get, like, an SF. I'm wondering how much emphasis Burden United want to have on their draft. We were talking about it as well with the whole you don't want to run an Enigma Chen kind of thing, because then you could just have all your experience leaked out, or maybe even some big creeps being taken out, or yourself dying, in fact. Is it still worthwhile, like, later in the game, still thinking that you could run it as a support bounty to get in on that action, instead of having to pull your offlaner off the offlane every time?
I think Matt plays those supports very well, the Bounty Hunter and the Treant Protector, the ones that just go invis and scout out and give information for his team.
Yep.
Everyone plays much better with vision, but Matt does a very good job of providing that for his team, and he's not afraid to die for it.
We're going to see a Shadow Fiend picked up, but it's on the dire side, typically the notoriously known weaker side for your Shadow Fiend. And usually what I'm told, or what I hear, the murmurs that are out there, is when you're committing to a Shadow Fiend this early and you're on dire side, usually you have something in mind for him. I don't know if you're looking to put something together with him, more minus armor synergy, building more around the Roche, a Roche kind of a lineup there, but that just seems to be something that kind of strikes me a bit peculiar. Overall, it's still, of course, a great hero. He's great as a mid lane dominator, can always transition to a great late game core, but, you know, it's dire side after all.
I do think they're very comfortable with these two heroes, though, as their cores. Mm-hmm. I think Necroman likes their Shadow Fiend a lot, so I would not be too surprised. It's just a fairly safe opening for them. Mm-hmm. The one thing that strikes me, like you were mentioning, Shadow Fiend on the dire side is very fragile. And if you have a roaming bounty hunter that focuses on the mid lane, especially if you don't run a jungler, then you need to have sentry wards down. I think it's very essential for the Shadow Fiend to sustain on that lane.
Well, I think that decides where this bounty hunter is going. Clockworker gets picked up. And, well, we saw Bulldog do his Nature's Prophet thing, and now we get to see him do his Clockwork thing.
I'm kind of surprised that Matt picks up the Clockwork here in the third position, because he could have played his cards a little bit better with keeping the bounty hunter and Leshrec a little bit more of a secret. I don't know if you really want to be picking up, like, Lotus here at this point of the game, but he could have kept Burden United potentially guessing. I don't know what you'd really bait out as far as a pick goes then, but
I think the only question then you can raise is, how much did these teams play against each other? And maybe he was afraid that the bounty hunter was going to get taken out. And, you know, it had happened to be a very strong pick against them.
Yeah. I'm just meaning, like, with the Clockwork pick up now, because that kind of, like, that's the first bit of information we've got that says bounty is going to be support. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, you potentially could have kept that a little bit more of a secret.
I mean, Clockwork's really good here. It was set up for Leshrec. He's really good versus their two cores, especially because of Blade Mail. Mm-hmm. And it forces them to get BKB very, very early on.
I want to go back a bit to this Leshrec, and it only strikes me curious because it's for Alliance. Alliance, I don't think, are notoriously known for running Leshrec very often. Yeah, a lot of teams love the hero. We already seen what it could do. Very dominant all throughout the game. But for them, not even near their top seven as far as picks. It's, are we set that to support?
Series. Last series, they got dominated by it first game, and then the second game, they banned it out.
So is it a Lota Leshrec, or is this going to be...
It should be a Pycat Leshrec. Like, if I remember, Pycat was the one who played it more.
Yeah.
Like, Lotus definitely played it, but...
Like, there's not enough time in this tournament for them to, like, adapt to a Leshrec. And if they're not used to it, then you might as well just play with it. Even if you can't play it amazingly, you can just play it at a decent baseline. It's way better than having to waste one of your bans on it, I'd say.
I think generally on the side of Alliance, to me, it's one of the teams that actually likes to play Leshrec as a core. I think both Lota in the very past, as well as Pycat, have played this hero. Mm-hmm. And to me, it's actually one of those teams that... When Leshrec became into this trend of a core role back in this patch, Alliance would be one of those teams that I actually see having that Leshrac in the core. So it's not very surprising to me. True. Here.
But it is starting to shape itself a bit. Now we see the Jug picked up, so it is going to be looking possibly like the Pycat Lesh in that mid lane. Jug, I've said this before when he was picked up, his heyday, of course, in that 6.83, when you can just grab that Mask of Madness, that Quelling Blade, do your casual rotation, get your early farm, try to get an early pick with your level 6 Omni Slash, then segue into the Roche, get that done, and continue to build on top of that. But since then, the Frog has decided we got to nerf him down. He got hit with nerf after nerf after nerf. Still, sometimes he seems to surface, but not nearly as prominent as he used to be. Is there any sort of significance on why Alliance decided to go with Jug, though, here and now?
He can go toe-to-toe with Gyro and Shadow Fiend with Spin and Omni Slash. He's notoriously good versus Shadow Fiend.
Mm-hmm.
Very true, but I think the Winter Raven is actually a fairly decent counter pick towards the Jugger.
Yeah,
on his spin, you have the ultimate, as well as you have your protection for your cores once the Omni slashes on them. I'm still trying to figure out why the second pick Bounty Hunter to me. Usually there's some connection in it, how he's been played out, but I can't really grasp it here. On the other side, Bounty Hunter has been, I think, what I heard from K-pop, one of the highest ELO win ratio heroes.
Oh.
So it's one of those when you have teams that go toe-to-toe that it has a very successful win rate. So maybe that goes for it.
And you look at Burden United, they already see that early Bounty Hunter, so they pick supports that are not going to be easy to pick off from a Bounty Hunter. You got the very fat and tanky Ogre Magi with his ridiculous armor and body weight to go along with it. And, of course, Winter Wyvern, who's got that Cold Embrace. He's got ways to quickly just kind of dodge out that heal and have some time for his allies to come and be by his side. So I am also going to be a bit concerned about this Bounty Hunter and what his impact will be in the game. And just to talk more about it, Winter Wyvern, back again. We found a lot of success with London Conspiracy as they were going against the Tiny Wisp. That felt really good with his Winter's Curse. You know, it was a pretty obvious grab, but here, I don't know.
I view Bounty Hunter as like a different flavor of tree. It's far more offensive, not as much anti-BKB, but he has a lot more burst with the Shuriken as opposed to like an AoE overgrowth, and then track really helps with kiting and keeping people alive. It's how a lot of teams have been playing it nowadays. Mm-hmm. As a support, and tree is just not good versus a lot of the popular heroes. Like Gyrocopter, living armor is absolutely useless. So, and he's also able to roam around a lot more effectively at level 1. So I would say he's like an evolved version of Treant, and teams play him like that.
So it does look like the Leshrac as the core in middle, yeah, for Pycat here, as well as having the Juggernaut for Loda, most likely on the safe lane. I do not assume they...
I looked back, actually. Through the last 30 games that Alliance have played, they have not played Leshrac on either Loda or Pycat. So
maybe
both scrims. Actually, yeah.
You know, they always could be scrimming
it's the old school stuff. Like, both Pycat and Loda are very, very old players.
Oh, yeah.
And, yeah, they've both played a considerable amount of Leshrac in their time.
Yeah. Finger on the Lion now, popping up. You get that additional burst here. So there's the rounded out lineup from Alliance. It's kind of a almost dead giveaway on how they're going to be sorting this one out. So is that a bit of an advantage now for Burden United? Because it seems almost kind of cut and dry at this point as far as what Alliance are going to be planning to do. Or is there a way they can kind of change this up a bit in the early laning stage to kind of throw off Burden United? Because I almost feel like they're going to have the upper hand. But then again, it's Alliance after all. And maybe they just feel that confident that their skill alone will be able to really succeed with that.
It's kind of difficult to get the upper hand up against this because, like, what are we looking at here? You got a Clockwork offlane difficult to kill. You got a Bounty Hunter harassing you out, and you're always going to be watching the back of your SF. You've got Lion, who I think was actually the greatest last pick ever, because now they can actually have a lot more disable, and they've got potential for initiation, which beyond the Bounty and the Clockwork, they didn't really have, and that could blow up in their face with what Winter Wyvern brings to their lineup.
Ooh, that hero was supposed to be dead. I thought he died.
He actually got three games in the Chinese qualifier.
Oh, yeah. That's right. And I did see on one of my other teams when I was like scouting on through, I want to say, maybe not Hellraisers, but Yellow Submarine, actually, they actually still run the Batrider. Now, his jungling, not quite the same as it used to be. It's much more difficult. There is a few changes that I guess you can look at in a sense to be a bit more positive. His Flame Break is now more of a dot. It's damage over time, not an instant burst. But guys, Batrider, why is he here now?
I mean, it still gives it a BKB disable.
Yes.
So, in a sense, I think the lineup of Burden United here is very strong to me. Like, the team fight is very solid. Everyone is kind of, like, tanky. It's a very robust kind of lineup. On the side of Alliance, you look at to me, it looks very like you have to make plays happen. You're like in and out of a fight. You don't really take that 5-on-5 against this against Burden here, but you're still like you get these quick pickoffs.
Yeah.
And I assume that's going to be the way that potentially Alliance is going to approach this game.
Yeah.
I'm Matt? Worried about the Winter Wyvern. I don't know if he's going to have that big of an impact. The only thing Cold Embrace is good against is Juggernaut, and he has so many ways that they can just die during Cold Embrace with all the magic damage. And on top of that, he can just get caught out really quickly. So I'm curious to see if he's going to be impactful. He wasn't in the NA qualifiers in the finals or lower bracket finals.
Yeah, it's very sketchy.
Well,
you got to consider that with the timing and call down, it could be a bit finicky.
I think it's time to leave you two alone so you can get some personal time with BU and Alliance.
Thank you very
much. Enjoy the game, man.
All right, honey. It's me and you. This is going to be our first time casting together, but I'm sure it's going to be a pleasure. So what do you think? Now you see the draft. You see the possible laning set up here as they look to kind of flirt around this rune area. What are your early impressions? Do you already think one team is going to have an early upper hand, or is this going to come down to who can really outperform?
On this side of Burden United here, I just think the draft seems very, like, sticky. You know, you go into it, it's...
Is that guy's Batrider?
I did not mean to go there, but I just feel it's a bit more versatile to me being Alliance here. You get your pickoffs, you can push if you want to, but if something on the side of Burden does not really work out, I feel like you have no... The gank potential is not entirely there, to me. You have a Batrider, sure,
yeah.
But it seems like you have a lot more pace to do if you're Alliance here.
I'm really curious. If that Batrider can make it past what is his new, very fragile early farm, early level phase that he can't really, you know, utilize like he did once before, his late game is always what it was. Great initiator, great lockdowner that goes through that BKB and he could set up the plays here. Early on, a little bit of harassment coming from both sides, just kind of asserting their dominance. But Batrider's not coming at it alone. He's got his good buddy Ogre to kind of help him out here. So they are... You know, making sure this Batrider has a relatively good time, and they're making sure that Loda does not have a good time, giving him that extra bit of pressure. He certainly does not like that sticky stuff. He's going to have to fall back on an early wand to make sure that he has the charges ready to go. And I was kind of also scouting out, you know, for Matt on this Bounty Hunter, I was curious if he's going to hang around that mid lane, going for the early Courier Snipe, but maybe that might be too predictable. But for now, he's still going to be tussling around the top lane.
I actually wonder why I didn't point it out that you have the Ogre plus Batrider bottom. It used to be that there was a phase where you played these two heroes on the offlane very often together, and I was in a team where that happened very often. I had a phase where I also played with Minots in the team. It's just a very strong dual offlane because both react on slow. Sticky is a pretty good spell when you have another slow factor in your composition, and Ogre is just so tanky. Just like Batrider, it's a nuisance to play against that on the lane. And on the side of, there was some engagement, but not much happening. So continuing to my thought of Trey, on the side of Alliance, you just have to watch out on that lane. It's just, in the very start, if you make a mistake, that lane can snowball very hard.
Lots of slow, all that sweet fire to stack on top of the napalm. Could be very deceptive and something Loda might need to look out for. And make sure he has that help nearby, but... It's not very defensive support help. It's just Lion. So Lion doesn't really get to be that bully. It's Ogre who's got all that sweet meat on the bones that can really kind of be the bouncer for the lane. So Minots is not going to be too scared about the presence that's coming his way. I mean, look at Ake's already got like 6 shots on him, and you wouldn't really think that by the look of him. But here's Mad now. Makes his adventure all the way from the top lane, and he's kind of scouting out.
He actually attempted a body block there, B, in the wind walk.
That's quite hilarious. Yeah, he's like walking in front of him. Smell my ghost farts, I guess. I don't know. It just doesn't really work that way. So he'll eat the early ignite, and he's going to be forced to walk away. Batrider gets the creeps right under the tower, and now, because Ogre's gone, he gets some sweet solo XP, so he can kind of get a bit more levels. And he's about to be level 4 at about 3 minutes in, so this is a good strong start for Paris on his Batrider.
Yeah, it actually looks like very... good dual offlane here, and like you were mentioning, they're getting their levels, and on the side of Alliance, you have to question yourself, is it good enough what Jugger gets right now on that lane? He seems to be in quite a struggle.
7-2 CS.
It's not looking good.
Yeah, that's not too great, so we'll see if the struggle kind of continues here. I mean, you could tell that their focus on this bottom lane is very apparent on the side of Alliance. They continue to have Mad coming by,
being there just to kind of help out. They have left Bulldog on his clockwork in the off lane. It seems like he's doing okay. He's 9-0 as far as CS goes. As for his level, he's level 4, but I must have caster cursed him because the second I point that out, they're going to make the go on to Bulldog now that the help is not there, and they're going to be getting the first blood. And of all people, it goes to Sing Sing on the gyro. They worked that out well, but on the other side of the world, chaos continues to break out. Now they're able to take down My Nuts. The Ogre will fall, but that's in exchange for Ake also going down. Still an advantage there for Burden United. So, quick and fast bloodshed coming out here, Hani.
It's not looking good at all for the side of Alliance here. I'm still trying to figure out what is Bounty actually doing in this game. So far, he has not really achieved anything. Mm-hmm. The comparison I always have when there's Bounty is Mousesports. Paladai, they pick it in the first two as well. Initiation on...
Yeah, they slow him a bit. The spin's there, plus the nice little toss, and hey, that gets it done. So I guess that's a reverse caster curse. You're kind of asking, what is Bounty Hunter getting done here? Well, he gets something done there, honey, so I hope you're happy. But now they managed to even the score up. Loda gets the help, gets an additional kill there. I believe he was the one who scored it, but still, very profitable for them in that off lane.
If you look at the mid lane, it looks like Pykett is actually stomping that mid matchup.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
And
29
that
and
is
nine.
Not to be expected to me. I think SF should be doing all right.
Yeah, you know, usually it's, you know, by the time he gets his level 4, level 5, he's got more into the raises, and I like that use of the illusions. They get the double stack on each of the camps, which it looks like he's going to have to use at this point because of how he's getting bullied in this lane. But, yeah, oh boy, it doesn't stop, though. Here comes a nice rotation from Aki in the north side, leading with the Hex. They got the stun, and I love that Lashrek with his new weapon kind of jabs him right down. So with that, just when we're getting ready to praise Burden United in this early laning phase, Alliance are able to shake it off. And now they start going and finding all the kills. So they now get one pretty much across the board. It's hard to say who's kind of taking control of the laning phase at this point.
I just think it's so important for the side of Alliance here that Pykett is, again, in this kind of leading position. Mm-hmm. He's winning his lane by a tremendous amount, and he has to be that force that brings him the victory. Like, he is the player pretty much that makes Alliance, you know, like push them upwards, yeah. Bring them into that comfortable position, whereas Loda can catch up then from there.
It's almost inspiring. He gets out there, he does his flashy movement, he gets these big early kills, and the confidence you can feel almost builds up around it behind him. They begin to thrive at that point. So we'll see if that's going to be the case here for this game number one. We see Bulldog dancing around with the pole camp there on the side, but obviously Burden United are kind of onto it at this point. And Paris now ventures away from his bottom lane. They leave it for the Ogre, and now he's looking to get involved, and this is kind of what we were used to seeing with the Batrider back in the day of 6.83 and before. Now he gets to work with the jungle a bit, builds up his farm, trying to get that blink dagger, but because they know he's alone on the bottom, well, hold that thought, they're able to get the quick easy pick with the help of the rocket barrage going for the bounty hunter, and then on the other side they're gonna go for My Nuts and they get that kill. Both sides kind of recognize who's out there and available. They know that the Ogre's alone, so they capitalize on that, but at the same moment in the top lane they scout out the Mad on the bounty hunter and they get their own kill there. Everything so far has been very back and forth. You take one, I got one.
Yeah, it seems quite even actually for this early game. And I think one thing to mention is that the big camp up there that Batrider took, I think they shared the experience on it, so it wasn't too bad for them at all.
Yeah.
Like, sure, Bounty Hunter died there, but I think he took a large portion of that experience. They shared it between, like, four heroes?
Oh, no. See, Bounty Hunter, this is where he's at his best. That was effortless. He just breathed on the bat and he fell over.
Getting a solo kill on a Batrider that actually looked pretty good in levels is tremendously important for the Bounty Hunter here. If he managed to get another level, he's going to be 6. And then you start with tracks. And if you don't watch out, a track can result into so much gold for your entire team.
Yeah, there'll be almost no coming back at that point. So good job from Mad. I mean, early on, it seemed a bit questionable, but at this point, he really makes it work, and that's the price you pay when you pick a Batrider into a bounty here. But here we go, the first cooldown of the game going to be dropping on top of him. The Wyver eating a lot of damage, but Pykett as well, who made the rotation. He's actually the one who's going to go down, but Bulldog, desperate to get some redemption, jumps on in, does slay the dragon, and now he's going to look to retreat. Ends up being a one-for-one that is still at the better of Burden United, getting that precious core, but can they get more? Minut's looking to move on in, but they don't have the detection to follow on up. Bulldog lays down the cogs, but Minut, he's like, I'm happy to go toe-to-toe with you. Now it's Bulldog on the run. Not much mana to work with. Look at the rocket barrage go right into the raises, and they're able to bring him down. Ends up being a 2-for-1 trade advantage for Burden United.
There was a little bit unfortunate here for the side of Alliance. They tried to go at the same time. They were not expecting to for a gank happening towards on the top lane. So kind of unfortunate. On the other side is I think Ogre should carry a dust on him. At least one person should carry that dust, because bounty hunter kills, especially when he's 5 now, they're actually quite valuable.
Oh yeah.
And you want to get those pick-offs.
We saw before all this. Meanwhile, Loda's getting his bit of farm on the bottom, 45 and 12 now for him. The big breadwinners are still between Pycat and Sing Sing at 51-50 CS apiece, so they're in a good spot right now. And Ogre is starting to build up those wards. It looks like he does have a sentry on hand now, just in case, but that tower does go down, and that money goes into the pocket of Loda. So a good big grab for them. But we're getting ready now to start developing towards that 10-minute mark in the early stages of the mid-game. So when the supports are starting to get their level 6s online, Hani, who do you think at that point really takes the upper hand advantage, or maybe just has the better team fight at that point with their supports really coming together? Is it the Lion having the finger and all that additional bursts, or is it maybe on the other side you look at the Winter Wyvern with his curse?
I think it really depends on the timing of the blink dagger on Batrider. For them, yeah, the initiation really matters on the Batrider, because anyone else can't really initiate, right? You have a... Sure, you have a cooldown. It's okay races and a potential Ogre stun, but it's still very hard to start a fight. On the side of Alliance, you wait for that level 6 on Lion. You have the finger. He is 5 right now, so that's still going to be a bit of a time. Then you have a Bounty Hunter who also needs a level 6, so you're pretty much going to work around that Clockwork Hook right now, and a potential Juggernaut ulti.
Necroman and company on the move with their smoke. That long-range curse just seems to come from another planet, and they're able to utilize it onto Loda. And because no one else was close, no one else going to get entrapped into it, just makes for an easy pick right there. And now suddenly we have an even game as far as kills go, 6-6. During this period, it looks like Sing Sing's going to take the opportunity to go for the jungle, but that's where Mad always seems to be. Goes right back in Viz. He's going to be stalking out his prey here, but he is just one man. He's not going to be able to do work on Sing Sing, obviously.
Sing spotted out on the top lane. They have a lane ward, and he spotted out that Clockwork was moving towards him. That's why he moved backwards, and yes, he knew that Bounty Hunter was around. So right now, he's just moving back to the lane. He kind of has the idea that Bounty Hunter is in the forest. Before, when Bounty Hunter TP'd onto the top lane, they had a sentry as well as an observer with there. So they 100% saw him walking by.
That's good recognition of game sense right there, to see the body language of someone like Bulba in the offlane. If he starts, you know, hunting, you know, hinting that he's going to be heading that way, then something's a bit fishy, especially with Bounty Hunter always off the radar. So good heads up there from Sing Sing, and obviously good ward placement to kind of get that bit of intel. So Mad is forced to go back on the move now. They really want to get what they can out of this track when possible. Loda back to his farming grace here. Are we going to be seeing more of the cookie cutter, if you will, Juggernaut build up like we saw from 6.83? It looks like for now he's got the bracer, possibly for drums. Also went with the Yasha on hand. Is there any sort of change up we're going to be having from a Jug, or anything that might be a special case for this particular matchup?
The only question that I have with an ice, you, if you want to get a Mask of Madness anymore, because Mask of Madness was picked up just as a tool because you farm so fast with the movement speed, but the movement speed on a Mask of Madness got reduced. When I looked at Lotus items, he didn't have a Quelling Light, and I'm wondering if he still wants to get that, because right now all he does is farm in forest, and it's way more efficient having a Quelling Light on you. Sure, it doesn't work against Roshan, but overall it's still, it's just like 32% farming faster, right? Essentially.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering on the side of Burden, why is no one trying to do anything about
that
bottom lane?
That sentry, they see Mad. They're going to move on in with the call down the rocket barrage, but he just puts himself even closer onto the sentry, and they are going to be able to get him. So a good, easy pick that was kind of gifted to him at that point. And I got to, you know, also want to put a note. I wonder if they kind of have an idea that this Batrider has this blink. He was stalking him previously, saw him finish farming the jungle, start heading towards the base, maybe had an inkling that his blink had been completed at that time. So there's no more of that usual surprise we like to see with your Batrider. You get the blink in the dark, you get your smoke, and you make a good first debut with it.
I was going to say a slight misplay by the Batrider here. If he would have checked that Gyro, or Gyro should have maybe told him that there was a track going, they saw the movement of Batrider behind the tower. So this gang was, there was no way that this gang is going to be successful. He should, like, in theory, Sing should be the one telling that he's tracked. Because he sees it on his hero without, you know, like, you have to check over every hero. Is he going to be tracked? So kind of a miscall there by Sing not telling him. But, well, unfortunately, it does not result into a kill, right?
Yeah. Tower pretty low, but not low enough for the deny. Burn United wanted to be walking away with that extra bit of a cash prize, but it looks like they might step back and regroup here. But Alliance obviously know. The Batrider has his blink, but mid lane there's going to be a breakout. Looks like a jump in for Bulwagog, making a go on for Necroman. Necroman, can he make it away? But here's Paris from that rotation, able to get off the lasso. They get the easy pick on the Lota of all people, and Bulldog might be in trouble here next. They look to turn back with the raise, but it's not going to be on the mark. Necroman, oh, there it is, and that's a track kill, if you will. Good Shuriken and bounce. They're going to be dishing out another track onto the Wyvern. Ends up being a one-for-one trade, your core jug for the core Shadow Fiend, plus you got to factor in that track gold.
Yeah. Overall, still it's an okay trade for both sides. Like, this game seems to be so even. It's always a back and forth in kills.
Yeah.
There's just exchanges happening. And like you were mentioning, there was a track going on, and I think three heroes shared that gold, so maybe the slight edge here for the side of Alliance, but it's minor.
Top, they were able to get that tier one, was Burden United, so they get that little bit of a bonus there. It's still sinking at the top of the net worth at this point. Actually, that was the gold. I was a little thrown off by that. There it is. He's still at the top of the net worth regardless. Thank you very much. Well, and then we look to Bulldog. He's been pretty proactive with his hookshot once he did get it. He's now working with this bottom lane here. It looks like he's going to be going for the blade mail. That's pretty interesting. Do you think there's any sort of significance on why he feels that that's necessary as opposed to maybe pushing for a four staff or maybe, you know, something else a bit more mobile?
I mean, I think to me, blade mail is a common pickup on Clockwork. I don't think it's anything really surprising. If he would have gotten something like Eels, I would be like, oh, this is quite interesting.
Minuts moves in like he can get something done, but he doesn't realize he is quickly outnumbered, and he may be big and bad, but oh, look at this, a save from the other side. Come with me on the high ground with this dragon, able to help him on out, but I don't think that's going to be enough, and that's another track set of gold into the pockets of Alliance. A good grab for them. They have to sweat it out a little bit, but I think they're going to be happy with the prize they've earned.
And if there's one thing you don't want to do, is give away these track kills. Mm-hmm. It just means too much. You have to walk as a team. I guess that's the hardest part about playing against a bounty hunter. You can't give these pickoffs. Even a support that's very underfarmed is going to give you so much value because of a track. Essentially, if you have five heroes gathered around, it doesn't even matter. It counts kind of like a carry, yeah, in a sense.
As far as item progression, we see the mech going to be complete on Necroman and his Shadow Fiend. And with that as well, we also see an early grab of the Soul Booster for Pycat. So obviously changing out those arcanes. He looks like he's going to be going for the standard quick build-up into your Bloodstone. So he's making fantastic pace, and of course credit for Mad being able to help out with those track picks. So they're in good standing right here. You have to fear a little bit. Burden United, they had that strong laning start, but their supports are still a bit starved right now. So being able to get them a bit of farm is very important.
Lotus was trying to find the Batrider here. On this side of Burden United, I feel like they need to make some plays with a Batrider. They haven't really tried to set any ganks up ever since he had that dagger, and to me it's the only initiation that they really have. Next to the Winter Riven, they could initiate with the ulti. They've done that onto Lota. It's pretty good just because it's instant and it has 800 range, so it's really hard for Lota to react to this. But other than that, the Yo's classic initiation is just smoke, Batrider, and you get a kill. And they have not tried to do that at all.
Is it just because they're not really trying to go for it, or could it be a bit difficult? It seems like with this bounty hunter in the game, they always have that bit of intel, or he's constantly dishing out an occasional track. It's just kind of hard to get a scouting report, or maybe Burn United are just a bit nervous because of that. And, you know, if you do a bit of a misplay on trying to make a committed go with a lasso and you end up not trading in your favor, you're going to be handing even more possible track hold over to Alliance. So, I don't know. Maybe it's a factor of nerves, but we're not really seeing, as you pointed out, those big jump-ins from the Batrider quite yet.
I overall think is the one thing they tried to do it was on the top lane where Singh was tracked, so that doesn't really count to me, and they have not used the smoke yet to make a play such as that. So on the side of Burn United, I think that is a go-to, unless you want to smoke for a Roche or whatever, something like that could be also a play. But you can't, like, this is a situation for Burden that is very scary. If a gyrocopter is alone like that, Ake is going to, he has his finger up.
Yep, he moves in. Call down does come from Singh. They get the track onto Minuts, and they're able to finish him off. And then they follow it up with Bulldog onto Singh, and they can get that kill here. Can they get the return to Pycat? The curse is there, but here comes the jump in from Paris. Looking to follow it up. Can they take down the Lesh? They certainly can, making it at least a 2-for-1 trade. But nice finger comes out, and they're going to be able to clean up the Winter Wyver. Come with me is going to go down. And now Necroman gets saved up a little bit, but he's still tracked up. They're on the prowl. Can Lota get the finishing blow here and secure even more of a bounty? It looks like they'll be able to. He has nowhere to run, nowhere to hide, and he will go down with a flurry. And that ends up being a 4-for-1 trade. My god.
And my original point was, where Gyro is alone on that top lane, it can happen. You need to sit together, and they're not trying to find the initiation. And it really depends on, if you're the reactive team, you're usually behind. If you're not the one that makes the plays, your response is always going to be too late. And against a hero like a Bounty, it's very crucial, because it spirals so fast out of control. 1, 2, 3 track kills, you're suddenly far behind.
Oh man, a Dagon pickup suddenly on your Bounty Hunter. You got even additional burst, rather, so that is very scary. Some of these supports, like your Winter Wyvern, could be a bit fragile. You add that burst on top of already the burst that could be coming out from your finger. Just makes for easy pickoffs one after the other. And like you said, it feels like Burn Unite are not being proactive enough with the power curve they seem to put, you know, give themselves at the early portion of this game. So they're kind of being a bit too submissive, it feels. And because of that, Alliance recognize it. They almost smell the fear, and they kind of just use that to their own power advantage. And I don't really foresee them really letting go. And it's more pressure on Burn Unite to kind of take this game back. They do manage to throw together the BKB onto Sing Sing, though. So they get that one defensive tool, but they still need more as far as damage goes.
What I see Pi often do is to just get that mana boots on Bounty Hunter. I actually feel like it's, to me, it's the better item.
Yeah.
Just because you need so much mana with the whole track, it just...
Yeah.
You have no regeneration at all right
Maybe
now.
Maybe a bottle sometimes, but yeah.
Potentially, arcane, like yeah. If you aim for the tranks, I just feel like having a bit of regen is quite nice, just because you want to throw out tracks all the time, so you have information.
Yeah.
And information is power. And in this case, he doesn't have that. Sure, he has quite a big mana pool, but I think it's still very important to have some sort of sustain, and it would benefit a lot of heroes. I think Lion, in some sort of situations, when you're in the team fight, he needs a full mana pool to do something. Sure, he can mana drain, right? It's not like that, but same with Juggernaut. Healing Ward and the cost generally of the spells of Jugger are quite high, so having an additional mana boots is pretty good.
Well, for him personally, at least he's able to step off. He gets the Dagon, which, of course, will add the intel now and all that burst that we were already talking about here. But as you see, Burn Unite kind of cowering together. Oh, Mad going for a ballsy TP here, but sorry, buddy, you're not going anywhere. So they're going to be able to catch him out. They have to commit the Winter Wyvern ultimate for it, but hey, a kill is a kill at this point. Burn Unite happy to take what they can.
It usually isn't that big of a deal, though. Bounty Hunter is supposed to scout. At least he gives information. He got another track out, so right now they at least know where their opponents are. So what Alliance essentially does right now is they just farm up. Are you happy with that situation where you go into late game just farming up?
Well, look at these two. Trading blows back and forth. Bulldog steps off for the hook shot. Drops down, very nicely placed cogs, but hey, look who can fly up and above, but still gets caught by it. I hate that. I'm in a game with a clockwork. I feel like I'm still like 4 feet away from the cog, but I'll still somehow get knocked by it, but he'll be able to make that clean escape. Good for him, but look at Paris. Uh-oh, flying on in. Now he's a froggy in the air, and they're going to be a catch him out. 1-2 punch comes out. It's Ake who gets the finishing blow with the finger of death, and they're going to be racking in another kill, and this time it's on the Batrider.
Slight miscommunication there. Leshrac was not following up on that stun, so Aki had to use his finger there. It was important, else Batrider would have potentially been out of there. But important kill.
Oh, man. And as you see, there's the Dagon going to play. He is able to kind of put himself into a, well, death cocoon. He's going to still get caught out from the cogs. Winter Wyvern goes down. Bulldog's going to be picking up that kill, and they just seem to continue to string one after the other. They can go right from one pickoff to the other. If it's a finger here, they'll still have a Dagon over there. They have, you know, the hook shot set up for this one. They'll have the Omni Slash for another. So Alliance seem to have plenty of weapons in their arsenal to make these continuous picks. And eventually, they'll just have enough of an economy and enough items that they can decide then to go for the objectives, then maybe go for Roche. But right now, it seems like they're very happy, you know, taking advantage of Burn Unite when they try to make a ballsy play or when they just find the picks themselves.
And again, these kills hurt a lot. It's track kills, essentially.
Yes.
And you can't just throw away these single kills because they mean a lot more. On the side of BU, they still haven't made... To me, the team feels very disconnected. They have not made plays together. They were not trying to smoke up. They have not tried to make any plays happen. They're not aiming towards getting that bottom tower or getting that mid tower. They need to make something happen. They need to use that blink dagger off the Batrider. And essentially, if you don't do that, and Alliance just keeps on getting track pickoffs, you're going to fall behind in a very fast pace.
And eventually, your map becomes more and more restricted because you're not being able to branch out and get those towers. Your farming options become limited. And then what limited farming options you got, you need to give to, like, Sing Sing on his Gyro, which means your supports are just going to get nothing. They end up just kind of starving out at one point. You're almost bottlenecked they can't afford to be in that kind of position. So eventually they're going to need to decide to work together, move out there, find those objectives, find some sort of kill to lead to those objectives. But for right now, it just feels like Alliance are, they have a firm grasp on the game. Thankfully, though, Sing Sing continues to farm on up, still holding their neck and neck with Pycat, at least on his Lesh, but he gets, you know, a Sage first. So the damage is still going to be prolonged quite a bit for your Gyro. He's just going more of a defensive buildup first and foremost.
Just looking at the situation, I'm just trying to think of the next play here for both teams. BU, very obvious, like I mentioned. On the side of Alliance, I guess trading so far is okay. Maybe you just want to pump up that gold into the Juggernaut and try to get a bit more items. Potentially, I think he was going towards the Scotty now. Is that the play? Yeah. He is missing out on the Mask of Madness. I was mentioning earlier, it's just not that great of an item anymore because you don't get this crazy amount of movement speed.
Yeah. But you get to SNY, so that helps a little bit. Move speed plus his face boots, so he's still pretty fast. He's just not race car fast like he used to be. So.
But the first smoke here, or as a team smoke for BU, it's 24 minutes into the game.
Yeah.
It just seems very late to me. And potentially Lota
could
even
lose it.
Oh,
this would be heartbreaking. And they already can see one pop, but they don't know if it's him. They don't know if it's maybe a bounty hunter who's kind of scouting him out. And it looks like the smoke is just going to amount to nothing here, Hani. That is heartbreaking if you're a BU fan. And all the meanwhile, they're just like, well, we know where you are, so we're going to continue to pressure this top lane. And really, what are you going to do about it? Matt is looking to scout out from behind the tower here. Oh, he's going to be a little too late if he wanted to dish out the track. Oh, drops a sentry, but they quickly deny it with their own. They drop an obs and it gets scouted out there from the BU sentry. So at least they'd be able to get that little 50 gold.
And it doesn't really seem like a team decision. The Shadow Fiend is trying to get that bottom tower, which he essentially is not getting. Now we have a TP rotation of Alliance towards that bottom tower. Getting that deny on the tower is pretty good. Another, you know, half the gold is just, it's just not good enough here. And it's very disconnected because the top tower is, it dropped more than 50% HP, and you just have to, you know, you just have to figure out what you want to do. And BU again, they just seem to not have a clue how to move as a team. They just very disconnected in their play.
It feels like just this bounty hunter Matt is just could be such a headache at this point. Seems like he's always there, he's always dishing out the tracks. They ping him out and then they're kind of uncertain if there's going to be a follow-up with him or if he's looking to make a committed dive onto something. It's just doesn't seem to really be happening for him. So you know, it's something we question as far as that early second pick, but clearly seems to be something that he's very comfortable with, at least for now. So we'll see if that's the case or not. It still just stands that Alliance are in good standing at this point. So,
and it looks like Lota is getting soon into that zone where he's comfortable with his items. So far, all he did is pretty much just farm. He just farmed. We see Lesh and Juggernaut pretty much on top of the scoreboard, whereas you have a Shadow Fiend. He's not just on par with a Gyrocopter. And I believe it comes down to that there's little decision making.
Okay.
What you want to do.
Jump in Lasso. It's on the Pycat. He already popped his BKB. Meanwhile, an Omni Slash node goes on to Nuts. Nuts is going to get saved up. Fingers still there. They're really trying to burst down the Ogre, but on the other side of the fight, they're going to make the turnaround, go into Pycat, and Pycat's going to be the one to go down. So it's a trade between him and the Ogre. Now they're looking to follow up, trying to get hold of Lota. The Rocket's already going to be out. Bulldog, though, interjects, jumps in, gets a nice set of cogs on the Necroman. He's going to be in trouble. Big stun to fly on out, and it's a triple kill. Of all people, goes to Ake on the Lion. Now it's Alliance looking to turn and take back the fight. Desperate TP force out from Paris is going to be successful, but look at this. It's Mad on the prowl. He wants to train a dragon. It looks like that's going to be the form of come with me. He goes down, and it's more track cold for Alliance. Turns out to be a 4-for-2 trade when you count the Lishrek drop, but he's already back to life because of the Bloodstone overall, and you can see it right there in the gold. It's very profitable for Alliance.
Great reactions there by Pycat. If you wouldn't have gotten that BKB out before he gets lassoed, the fight would have been actually quite terrible. He managed to pretty much delay the fight a lot so the team could catch up, because this fight was looking pretty good for the side of BU here.
Yeah, I mean, and they even pull him over to the side away while Alliance have their hands full with the Ogre, but as you see right there, they can't really do much to Pycat because of the BKB, and it takes longer than they would like.
And as you can see on the bottom, that bounty on the TP on the second tower, he was so far away at that point of this fight.
But they get there in time, especially Bulldog. He jumps right in, catches Sing Sing, it looks like, off guard. And because that, they're able to easily turn around. Lota's already in the safety zone. They're managed to drop Necroman, and this is where they could just turn it right back onto him. Paris, luckily to make it out, but Come With Me was not so lucky. So back to the farming grace for Alliance here. They're already in a great spot at this point, and it looks like they have eyes to at least scout out the Roche, but I wouldn't be surprised if it's something they consider going for themselves. They might need to get a pick before they can easily secure it first, but they just seem to be... I feel like I'm a broken record at this point, but they're just getting what they want at this point over and over again.
Yeah, right now we saw the Bounty Hunter picking up Dagon 3. I'm usually a fan of keeping a Dagon 1 and then having a dagger so you have another escape mechanism when you want to track people so you can play a bit more aggressive on the track because you can just get caught by a Batrider.
Yeah.
And essentially, you can also just, you know, go further aggressive into the jungle where you scout out a bit more, then you get a track off. You just feel a lot safer having a dagger on you. He goes for the burst, which is not terrible.
Oh, Lasso. They scout out Pycat. They pull him back. They get the call down there. A jump comes out from Bulldog, and it's a big cog catch. He's able to force himself away from trouble here, but the fight's going to become split. Paris looking to make a go into Bulldog. Come with me. Gets slashed on the part. Mad secures another kill with the track and dishes the mount out. Rekum going to fly. Really good damage on the load. Going to be able to finish him off, but look at the Ravage coming out from Ake with his Lion. But when the dust settles, this is a profitable fight for Burn United. The biggest one they've had what feels like almost all game. They do walk away because of that minor rubber band rebound. They do come out with a pretty damn significant XP advantage.
That was quite a big ulti by Necroman there. Mm-hmm. He actually hit the perfect timing on the Jugger ulti when it stopped, so Jugger just dropped instantly to like 40% health there. And it looks like a buyback from Jugger, but is he able to do anything in this fight?
Oh, they really want to contest. Mad dishing out the track, trying to get the intel while they're working into the pit, but here's Loda. He's already on the scene. He's looking to move on forward, but he does not have that Omni Slash, so he's doing this out of solo. Just starts spinning in there. Okay, again with a big stun. How does this guy do it? Catches it big, follow up with the finger, and now it's on to Mad. They are able to bring him down. Aki getting himself out and away from a corner, but Burn United's still going to be able to hold their own. Roche is only down to about half life here, but look at Pycat charging on forward, not going to be able to catch the Earth Split here. On the other side, this just becomes a bit discombobulated from both sides. Minot's, though, very starved for mana. Not going to be able to make it away as Bulldog shows up in the nick of time to catch him out with the cogs. He gets saved temporarily from the Winter Wyvern, but can't save him from the Dagon, the upgraded one that comes out from Mad. And because of that, come with me, desperate to try to contest the Roche, but he gets himself up to a pedestal, but it's a pedestal of death. He still goes down, and it's Alliance who are able to take away the Roche for themselves. Oh, it looks so helpful for Burning United, but Alliance, the heartbreakers here.
And when the fight starts, I was mentioning how I was kind of not very comfortable with a buyback by Loda, but when you see a stun from Ake like that, I would take that fight if I can be that confident in hitting that kind of stun.
I mean, Merlini said in the draft he felt that the supports for Alliance were a bit silent. Well, they're screaming out now that they got the skill to back it up. And, wow.
But next to Aki's great initiations in terms of stuns, like, it's pretty much ravages from him.
Oh, yeah.
But Admiral Bulldog as well.
Like, oh, yeah.
His hookshots are spot on in these fights. He before the fight, he got a three-man cock. Mm-hmm. It looked like that. And then he forced himself out. And the second one was just a clutch catch. And these Aki, especially as well as Bulldog, they are performing here.
These guys are veterans on the side of Alliance.
They know what's on the line here.
They have been to the big show, the biggest show. This can almost feel like just a walk in the park at this point for what they've been, you know, used to. But, Mad, fortunately, a little out past the safety zone. They have that Sentry Ward in the mid lane. He ends up feeding a little bit over, but it's not anything too devastating to Alliance. But this is good for Burn United. Because of this kill, they can finally push on forward and take this Tier 1 tower. Finally, all three Tier 1s go down, but now they have to consider a way to break on past and go for the Tier 2s. That Aegis, though, still on the side of Alliance. They have that extra life advantage, but BU, they continue to work together, and they just continue to truck down this mid lane.
Mad really wants to finish that Dagon fight before getting any utility. And they actually spot out Loda here.
Oh, they're going to see him in time. He gets down the ward, quickly rises. He might be spotted out, goes for a spin, but they've already put their sights on the Ake. They pull him back. They get rid of that little lion, and he did have a little bit of a bounty on his head, a mega kill streak worth 601 gold pieces. And they're also going to take the tower. So, honey, all day, they take the Mad Bounty Hunter down. They get Tier 1, they get Tier 2, plus the lion. That's a pretty big sweep their way.
And that was such a respect play to me. Batrider, if I was Batrider, I would take the carry over the support anytime. I felt like he had all the vision with that ward set down that he could have gone for Jugger there. And if he went for the Jugger with a follow-up Winter Raven ultimate, he would have been dead. I'm pretty sure he would have been dead. Oh, he does have the Aegis though. Oh my, that's on me. He has the Aegis though. He actually has the Aegis, so it was the right play.
No, I mean in that heads up moment for someone that think that straight, I agree with you. You'd see someone like Jug and you're like, that's the profitable grab, you gotta go for it. But yeah, he has that extra life and I don't think all that necessary action probably would have been worth just ridding of the Aegis alone. So instead taking advantage of that just micro rebound factor and being able to get themselves back to the game is very profitable for them.
Could have been me in game there. I would have gone for it.
But it just goes to show that any player in those shoes, in the heat of the moment, you never really know, and that's what can separate someone who's has their head in the game and someone who just kind of can panic almost at that moment. So I guess in some props to Paris for making the right decision at that moment. But is that enough, though? Is that enough for Burn United to make their way back into this game?
I would say it's still quite even. I feel like the Winter Raven, he's such a good counter to Jugger, where usually when Jugger can start an ultimate, he seems to be like, he's very confident in his play, right? He goes in, he just omni-slashes someone, but he has to watch out every time he uses that ulti. And so far, Winter Raven always countered him quite well on the omni-slash usage. So it's not as easy for Loda at all to get a good ultimate off here.
With that, it looks like they're going to be able to charge down this bottom lane, the south side for Burn United, as this tier 2 in jeopardy. Pycat, of course, with that edict, just kind of melts through these towers like butter. And yeah, you see Mad still dishing out the tracks.
We see a bit of split pushing going on, but it doesn't seem as decisive. They're not going for the split push fast enough, and it hurts a lot. You're losing a tier 2, you're not getting anything done on your tier 2. And, essentially,
yeah.
Your map gets smaller and smaller.
Mm-hmm. What we saw right there before Necromantique being out, he was tracked, and because he was tracked from kind of an unknown spot without being spotted, they kind of get the idea that there are wards in their jungle. They're already pinging it out. They're going to need to kind of debunk that. Looks like they're already on the scene. He drops a sentry, but it's not near the ward. I guess they just didn't think it would be in the obvious spot, but it actually was. So double mind games or something, but regardless, Alliance still get that extra bit of intel in the deep woods of Burn United.
It's a minor thing here, but when I look at Leshrac's items, I look at that power treads, I'm a bit confused. He got those power treads after he had the mana boots,
yes,
right?
And yep.
the soul booster.
Normally boots of travel, right?
I'm just wondering if you want to keep those as brown boots, but I guess he enjoys having those power treads and extra hits, potentially a bit more HP on top of that. But is it going to... I just feel like you want to exchange those fairly quickly.
Yeah. Eventually, he'll probably build into some serious life that even power treads might not be necessary for. Let's say if he decides to, after the Shivas, go for like an Octarine core, then you're pretty damn big for a Leshrac, and the boots don't really seem to match up. And eventually, you're going to want to maybe get that extra bit of mobility, like the boots of travel. So we'll see what he decides to do with the little brown boots there. But using their little booties, it's Alliance walking around all smoked up, trying to catch an opportunity for maybe catching up Burn United, but I don't know if the smoke was scouted. They're in a very defensive position just inside their own baseline.
I'm not entirely sure if it was scouted either, but you can clearly see that Burn United knows what's up. No one is showing on any lane, and it's the right decision to just stick together in base. At least for the time when people are missing, having like 1 minute, probably around that time, okay, the smoke is gone. At least you're not running into a smoke anymore. And then if you move out together, and they are moving out together right now, it's a good decision making that you should still stick together if you can't see anyone. But at least like 1 minute, staying back 1 minute is pretty good. Just because you could still be in a very disadvantage because everyone else around you can be in this. And that can be very tough for you.
Good heads up. They're not going to make the immediate jump onto the illusion. But speaking of jumps, it's Bulldog making the jump onto Paris. Paris able to pop his BKB, but he dies so damn fast. Just that quick slash at the end is able to bring him on down. And now the threat of the Batrider off the field for almost a minute with no buyback. Ooh, nice little force right there. Don't know if that stun would have connected regardless, but it's better to play safe against someone like Ake, who seems to be on par with his stuns. So still 40 seconds, no Batrider. Are we expecting Alliance to kind of take advantage of this 5v4? I don't think Roche is going to be up quite yet, but yeah, they got a little bit of time before even the 8 minute mark, but it's their time.
That he has a lot of items. That's a dagger, a four step, and he's working towards a potential hex, I assume. Maybe a Lincoln's. He could actually work towards that Lincoln's as well to help against that Winter Raven ultimate.
Oh yeah. It could be. And the Batrider lasso.
Yeah, exactly. It could be actually quite a good item to have here. On the side of Burden, I'm not sure what you want to do here. I was actually considering the draft scenario, and What is happening?
They're trading. This is a ward battle. And Ake's like, you want to go for the ward? I'm going to go for you. He jumps in with Mad. They get the kill. They get the ward. And they're like, don't even think about it. Oh, disrespect from Alliance here. And oh, Hookshot going to be coming up short. Looks like they tried to make a go on to come with me, but they're not going to get it.
Usually it's quite a bad sign if you know a line is around and you are tracked up, you probably just leave that ward alone. Like, it's not that big of a deal. Instead, you give a track kill away. Again, this hurts.
It's a lot of gold. Yeah. One thing that is going for Burden United is because all the meanwhile, Sing Sing must have really had his nose to the grindstone for his farm. He's still king of net worth, not by a lot. Nipping at the heels, of course, is Pycat and Loda and his jug, but is this one gyrocopter really going to be enough? Shadow Fiend for now just seems to be a little behind, so it seems like it's going to be more pressure on Sing Sing to dish out that flat cannon spread across the whole team of Alliance and bring it back.
Yeah, that's very true. And going back to my original point here, your only real initiation is a Batrider.
Yeah.
Getting something done is mostly over that Batrider. And they picked the Batrider as the last pick into a Bounty Hunter. Bounty Hunter is actually fairly good against the Batrider, just because once you have the track off, Batrider needs potentially having something like Eels, you know, so he gets rid of that track quickly, because you don't want to be in vision at all. Or you want to get a Shadow Blade, something like that, so he can stay away from a Bounty Hunter. Then Bounty Hunter at least needs something like a gem.
Yeah.
But having none of that, and your entire initiation relies on being the Batrider, it's quite tough for you.
I mean, maybe off the top of your head, I'm trying to think about it as well, could there have been other options for the offlane that could still fill that role like a Batrider on being a good initiator? Popular pickups have been like a Beastmaster. You could be pretty strong, give a blink to him, and he'd be able to set it up. But, you know, it's reaching back to this Batrider, not quite in the heyday like it used to be.
I'm not sure if there could be any other hero, but we see a smoke happening.
Yeah, they're moving in. This is very sketchy. Oh, they're so close. They don't even know yet. Oh, Sing Sing moves right into a Hex. He's not going to be able to get the BKB off. They're going to burst him down. Meanwhile, Paris, though, gets the pullback on the Pycat. Necroman getting off the Requiem. They might be able to burst down Mad here. Yes, they will. Paris is able to torch him on down. Sing Sing holds strong. Drops down the call down. He gets a killing spree for himself as he charges on in. This might be Burden United's time. They're able to clear it on out, but Pycat gets his own set of kills before he's going to be dropped here. Loda, not going to be able to scout out Paris. Paris going to make it away, and oh, Bulldog thought about trying to get him. Not close enough, of course, for the battery assault. When the dust does settle, it's a 3-for-3 here. A core apiece, but it is Sing Sing who also ends up going down here. That was a very hairy kind of a situation for two teams to meet in the jungle front.
I'm actually considering still right now is if the BKB of Gyrocopter is not popped and you get that defensive spell off the Winter Riven, can you perch it off? Is it Diffusion possible to take that off? Because it seems so strong in these fights.
Yeah, you see it right there. Now, they kind of stacked the ultimates together. The lasso was used on Pycat, then they used the curse also. So it's a lot of hate for one Goatman. Paris is able to move to the back, clean out the backstaff here. Hockey sends himself into a call down, so that doesn't really work out too well for him. But you have Bulldog also coming in from behind with the help of Loda as well, and they're able to kind of dish out and take down what's necessary. So, almost ends up a bit of a wash, but, you know, with the game has already progressed, and now you have Alliance able to kind of move into the Roche pit here. Uh-oh, we might see contention. Look who's nearby. A flame break early, not going to be able to bump up to the high ground. Oh, can we see a steel play here? It doesn't look like they're going to go for it. You have Mad all the meanwhile scouting him out. Oh, okay, nice jump. It's a Hex and the finger follow-up. Trying to go for Paris and Bulldog. Makes the jump in on two. Able to finish off. Come with me. Now looking to go for My Nuts. My Nuts able to bump his way out of there. Mad going to get caught up with the lasso. He ends up going down. Makes it a one-for-one trade between two supports. And now Sing Sing charging on forward. Loda, though, persistent. Looking to make his move. Doesn't want to overcommit here, even with the Aegis on hand.
I do understand the play there by Ake. He just wanted to be reactionary. He wanted to make that jump before Batrider potentially jumps into steel. But it didn't even look like Batrider was attempting to go for that steel. Overall, I do understand, though. I assume it was the right play. You want to just make sure you get that Aegis and it does not fall into the hands of the Batrider there.
Yeah. Usually if the Batrider is going for the kill, he'll like from what I've seen at least, you time out the flame break to get it right the last moment so you could spread him apart, jump and snag that Aegis and get the hell out of there. But it was a bit early, just kind of maybe getting an idea as far as what Alliance were doing in there. But yeah, that quick correction from Ake puts him in a bit of an awkward spot. They end up trading blow for blow here.
I'm still looking for that the mobility on Bounty Hunter. I felt like he gets too close in these fights. He just dies so fast. His 900 HP just blows up.
So much of an investment to get this Dagon leveled up.
He has a Dagon 5 now, right?
Yeah.
That's five.
But that's what
no, that's
what
four.
He's got.
Okay, that's four. He has Dig and four, but that's it. And I don't agree on leveling it a bit higher. I don't really think it does that much. I feel like he could have been a lot more active in these fights by just tracking up people. You want to track, because Jugger just gets kited. As soon as Bounty is down, you don't have that 20% movement speed anymore. Mm-hmm. And you're not going for Mask of Madness, so you essentially you rely on another tool that speeds you up. And if Bounty dies, the fight gets a lot harder. And the previous fight, the one not Erosion, but the one before, if Pykit was not able to get three kills there, and if he would have died just a second earlier, the fight would have been catastrophic for the side of Alliance, just because Jugger gets kited.
It might not get any easier, though, for Bird United. We saw that Ake almost has that link into complete, so those big ultimates that have been working pretty well for Bird United to kind of keep them in this game with that setup might not be as easy here. I saw the Perseverance was already done, so just a recipe away before he gets that extra tool. Yep. So with that, Bird United still moving as a group here. Get that out of the Roche pit. Barra's able to quickly deny out the item, but here they pull back, and we're almost still at a bit of a wash.
Holy Hannah, he's fat. That Cocker has items, but he went for the Lincolns over getting an Aghanim's. It's interesting item choice, but I guess they really want to have the Lincolns for the carries.
Really want to make sure both Pyke and Loda do not run into too much trouble. So I guess fair enough as it is. And oh, look at this.
We have to dig in five. At least now he's set to go for mobility.
Finally, he can get something else. So we'll see what that something else might be. And a Yule's also done for Paris on his Batrider. So I feel like that might be something a bit more defensive, perhaps. I guess it gets rid of a track if necessary, but could also make a bit of a setup, or at least just toss someone like Loda or Bulldog or whoever up in the air, get him out of the fight.
It was a bit better against the old track when it was somewhat longer, but now at 5 seconds, it's not as great. But
bit irrelevant, yeah.
It's just like, if you're tracked up, it's super annoying as Batrider to stay there for like, 45 seconds? It's around there, right?
Yeah.
For the amount of track, and then you just sit there, and you can pretty much just wait. Unless you're farming, you're in a position where you don't really accomplish anything.
Yeah. 30 seconds, apparently. Thank you very much. I believe Scriff right there as our ops, scouting it on out, and giving us a bit of info. But still, feels like an eternity at this point in the game, 30 seconds. So, yeah, we'll have to see. Hey, plus you get that little bit of extra move speed on your Batrider. But here they go. We don't see very often Bird United kind of crossing that river, looking for anything aggressive. Normally, it's Alliance going into their neighborhood, but maybe they're feeling a sense of confidence. But as that happens, Bulldog makes a jump in. Good force save. He's going to be helping out with Come With Me. But are they going to make the follow-up here? Aki's looking to move on in. It's in a nice little choke point, so they're kind of second-guessing their commitment. There's going to be the call down, and now Loda going to get caught up with the lasso, pulled back while he does go for the Blade Fury, but they're going to be able to easily focus him. He is going to get the Omni-Slash off. They're going to try to stay alive here. Another big stun from Aki from the high ground here. Necroman's going to end up going down. Sing Sing, who is tracked up, trying to go blow for blow with Loda, but you're not going to be winning that fight. Ends up being a three-man takedown. Alliance lose no one. Good kind of second jump right there. They thought they could just immediately go in. They double back a bit, and then they kind of reanalyze, it seems, the situation, and then they go on forward, and, well, they end up walking away the big victor. And look at that XP gold swing. Now it's Alliance's time. They're charging down this mid lane. They want to start doing some base damage, and already it's going to force Sing Sing to dish out the buyback.
For a moment, I was a bit afraid there with Lotus Blade, but I just didn't see that Aegis. Okay. I do not know why, but what happened there with Loda, though, is Loda to me is one of those players that if he needs a crit or he needs a bash, he gets those. And he just got in that, when he used his Omni Slash, he got a crit onto the Winter Raven.
Oh.
And if he didn't get that, the Winter Raven could have potentially used any spell. But he died on a crit, and that essentially made the Omni Slash pretty good.
Loda praying to RNGesus, and RNGesus delivers. What a big surprise for a guy who's invested so much time into Dota. I guess he has to get rewarded with something after all. But there you see the Lincolns is going to be complete on Ake. Now you have double Lincoln Sphere now, so I assume probably sharing it one apiece for their cores, whoever might try to be the frontliner at this point. They didn't seem to do any real significant damage in the base. Overall, it did, of course, cost Sing Sing his buyback. So another big fight. If it tends to go sour for Burn United, then they might be noticing some
and
real
look
base
at
work.
That Bounty Hunter. That next item he's going for.
What is it?
That's a four staff.
Oh, the four
mobility.
Staff.
He's getting the mobility.
Yep.
It's not a dagger, but I'm all right. Having that four staff, it's something, right?
Yeah. You can always use it on ally if you need to, you know, save them in a bit of a pickle. Why not, right?
Pretty good. Yeah. And we have a smoke here by Alliance now. I'm wondering what they're trying to achieve. I guess they're just walking down the mid lane.
Oh, but a smoke play from Burn United. Will they get to a point where they can creep in from behind here? Doesn't look like it. Looks like the opportunity might have to pass. And,
they see everyone there.
Uh-oh. Suddenly Alliance is like, what are they doing over there? They're going to make the jump in. Immediate jump in. The Omni Slash. Sing Sing is dead. No buyback. And this has gone to hell for Burn United. Alliance in a prime position from that high ground are just going to commit on forward. They immediately reduce three. And I do not blame them for this. They throw in the towel. It is GG. And of this best of two, your first match is going to go to Alliance.
Quite a questionable play there by the support side, destroying the observer ward when you're smoked. You know Alliance does not show up, so there's a pretty big chance that they're smoking themselves. You take the vision away, Gyrocopter moves by, he's in vision, so the fight starts completely on the side of Alliance.
Yeah, it was heartbreaking for them to see right there, but what do you think it was? It felt like it was pretty good at the start for Burn United, but then we were talking about how they might have felt a bit reserved. They had this Batrider, they had this Blink Dagger, but they weren't really using it. We weren't seeing like smoke movements come out. It seemed like they were just a bit too perplexed maybe with the Bounty Hunter kind of being up in their face and dishing out those tracks. What was the point where Burn United really couldn't get the game back their way, or what would we kind of hoping for them to do to kind of get themselves back into it?
I felt like essentially Batrider needs to do more, but they also just had to move more as a team. It's mm-hmm. a team effort. If you go for objectives, you can use your smoke to get into that position. You have to make sure your lanes are pushed out, and then you want to get an objective. And I felt like they were quite disconnected on how they farmed around the map. There was not really much going on, and essentially you just have to make something happen out of your smokes. And if Batrider is your one initiation, you need to do something around the Batrider.
Now, for the other side, of course, we've got to praise Alliance because they did win after all. What do you think was the key factor for them? We know Loda was continuously farming on his Jug. He built up a good base where he could finally make the fight happen. Pycat got some work done. It seemed like whenever they were able to bring down the Pycat Lesh, he still managed to die, at least taking one, two with him. But I think, without a doubt, it's Ake. Ake and Admiral Bulldog, man. They just got so many sweet setups. Ake with the Ravages back-to-back. Bulldogs always seem to catch out those great hook shots and cog setups. I mean, would you agree with that?
Ake, the clear tight under in that game.
That was ridiculous.
He does these crazy Ravages.
It was crazy.
It was great performance by both Ake as well as Admiral Bulldog. The one thing to mention is the pretty strong laning phase by Pycat. He went way past that Shadow Fiend, and in a one-on-one, it should not happen like that. Maybe he was too afraid of the Bounty Hunter that he could potentially not see, so he played more passive, but he had a Sentry Ward down, so mm-hmm. You have to make more out of your laning phase, and I feel like as soon as Shadow Fiend gets to level 3, he shouldn't be that far behind.
I can agree with that. So, at the start, Merlini calling out for Alliance and the supports. They're a bit too silent. Well, they're not silent now. They're singing, and they're making work done. So, with that, that's just game number one. So, we'll be back in a few moments' time. And when we return, we'll get game number two of Burden United going against Alliance. We'll see you soon.